Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our webinar. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. My name is Jumana Tariq Nabil Abdurazik. I'm studying for a master's degree in petroleum engineering at University of Houston, and I will be your moderator this afternoon. Today, we're pleased to welcome Dr. Mohammed Gharib, a very special guest from Egypt. Dr. Mohammed Gharib has a PhD in petroleum engineering, specifically in artificial lift production engineering and operations. Dr. Gharib is a technical and business professional with over 34 years of experience in oil and gas business operations, management, engineering, sales, and teaching. Dr. Gharib was the Eastern Hemisphere Technical Director at Lufkin, as well as the Regional Technical Director of the Middle East, North Africa, and Turkey at General Electric Oil and Gas. He then worked as Vice President of the Eastern Hemisphere at SSI Lift. Now he works as the Strategic Business Director for the Eastern Hemisphere at Weatherford, and petroleum engineering professor at Future University in Egypt. And today he will continue to share with us his expert opinion on the artificial lift techniques. If you haven't already, please make sure to check out our previous sessions on Pai Petro YouTube channel and join our Facebook page, Arab Oil and Gas Academy, for the latest updates on our September and October courses. Please feel free to send your questions in the chat box and we will answer as many questions as possible. With that, I ask you to give your full attention to Dr. Mohammed Gharib and help me in welcoming him. Please welcome one of my all-time favorite professors, Dr. Mohammed Gharib. Hi, Dr. Gharib. Thanks for joining us today to pick up where we left off in the artificial lift technologies course.
Thank you, Jumana. Thanks. Assalamu alaikum. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. I hope all of you are doing well. Yeah? Today, just to still continue in the second part of our artificial lift technology and system, it is electric submersible pump. We covered already the road lift system in three lectures, and today is third lecture for ESP, and we spent a little bit quite long time in this main two artificial lift, because as I mentioned before, you know, this is the two main artificial lift it's using worldwide, you know. The number of wells, the road lift system is the first, the volume of production, the ESP, is the first one. Today, just we'll try to go through some of just maybe just like a design, how to design system, how to select the system. We already covered before, you know, just in summary, the main component for downhole equipment and for surface equipment. And we said that for downhole equipment, the heart of the system, it is the pumps. And the pump, there is an intake connecting to the bottom of the pump, and the intake can be just standard holes if there is no gas. If the volume of gas is than 20% or less, we can use just standard holes to feed like a manifold, feeding the pump with the fluids from the well pores. Or can be a separators, you know, just to replace the intake like a separators. While the separators, it separated the gas, a high volume of gas, you know, separated before just the fluid entering to the pump. And we said that there is different type of separators. There is a dynamic and there is a static. And since there is ESP, is in the dynamic separators, it's the best efficient separator for that, for this one. Plus there is a seal, you know, we said that there is a seal section. This pump is driven by electric motors, and not an easy just to connect direct electric motors to the pump, and will be a contact of fluids and so on. Then there is a seal just to protect, mainly to protect the motor and so on. And at the end, there is a motor at the bottom of the bottom hole assembly of this is downhole ESP assembly. Plus, the motor, it's an electric motor driven by powers, and usually the source of the power come from the surface, you know, and for that reason, there should be a power cable connecting the downhole motors to the surface equipment, which transfer the power from surface power generations to the downhole motor after adjusting the power based on the motor designed and selected, like the fault and hertz and so on, you know. This is, you know, just five main parts, you know, this is a chain. If one of them is broken, if one of them is missing, the system cannot be running. But currently, you know, just also there is what we call downhole monitoring sensors, this ESP, and there is a cables. Why I not use a cable to monitoring my downhole equipment to optimize my performance of downhole equipment to reduce the failure by predicting the failures in time, in time to know what's going on and so on. However, as I mentioned, there is a 5 mm part is a chain plus the tubing which is connecting the downhole assembly to the surface where the flow, its flow inside the tubing to the surface. And the bottom hole, it's optional equipment, it's the bottom hole sensors, but however, majority of the ESP currently have, this is one of the equipment. In summary, what we said about the equipment and how it's running for ESP equipment, we said that the pump is required to produce a fluid. The pump, it's just converted the fluids, the shaft rotation of the motor to into flow and just give some what we call power energy to the fluids, And the main concept of the pump is running by centrifugal force. It's a centrifugal pump. Then the main force it's converted to the fluid is centrifugal force. Plus intake, as I mentioned, and there is two types of intake, either standard intake if there is no gas, or gas separators and so on, The pump, there is different type of pump, depends on downhole condition, depends on fluid properties, what I have, if there is a sand, if there is a gas, if there is a corrosion, how the pump configurations can be selected, how the impellers and diffusers can be selected. Is there is a special pump? Yes, for sure. There is a special pump to handle sand, special pump to handle gas, pump can handle heavy crude oils and so on. Technology really in ESP just improved too much, which can allow you just to run ESP for variety of oil condition and fluid condition and so on. Plus a seal, as I mentioned, it's just a protection. It's a protection for the motor and the motor which converted electric power to rotation, which transfer to the pump and just produce fluid. Cable to transfer the fluid, to transfer the power from surface to the motor, sensor plus surface controller. We must have a surface controller to control downhole and monitoring the downhole equipment. And so today we start just to go in very brief and very principal things about design. How to design, how to select, we'll not go in details. In the market, there is a very good software, scan sizing and design, selecting the equipment for the ESP, but what the concept of this software, how the software is running and so on. This is what I want just to give you some basics about in order to understand how to run the software, what the data you need to input to softwares. If you understand the basic, you can run the softwares in a very efficient way and so on. Since we start just downhole, we said for all artificial lift, usually we start your design with the downhole pumps. Then we need to select the downhole pumps. How the downhole ESP downhole pumps is working? How it's generated, what we call power to the fluids? How it's produced fluids? What the function between the head of the fluids they are lifted and the production? Is there is a difference? Yes. There is what we call the main common terminology here. It's what we call pump performance curve. And the pump performance curve, really, it's a change with time, huh? Because the efficiency of downhole pumps can be changed, If the efficiency is changed, then there is some shift will be in the heads, in the fluids. It depends on how it's running and so on. For that reason, especially after you are pull out for all the pumps and you do some maintenance and redress, you need to retest the pump and generate a new performance curve for the pump. What is a pump performance curve? The pump performance curve, it's mainly a relationship between the flow and the head. The flow of the pump can be produced and how much head the pump can be lifted. Usually this curve is represented for one stage of the pump. Then usually you are draw or just you are construct your pump performance curve for each single stage at a certain parameter we'll see. Then the pump performance curve represent in this axis, in vertical axis, is the head. The head is how much the stage is lifted the flow, how far is lift the float, 1 feet, 2 feet, 3 feet, 10 feet, whatever. And the production, flow rates, at what production, how much production is produced. Then the performance curve is mainly just, this is in a very simple way, plus you have some other main parameters we can show in the performance curve. But one of the main important parameter for the performance curve, it is a head against the flow rate of the. What is the head? And how the head is constructed and so on. This is a ESP assembly, and this represents the head. Then the head, it is the height to which the pump will lift the float. Here, if we start to talk about the performance curve, then we can say the height to which this pump stay to lift the float. Then if I need more heads, then I use more stage and so on. There is one very important phenomenon for centrifugal pump. This is an centrifugal pump, not a positive displacement pump. For this type of pump, whatever type of fluids you have, oil, water, propane, whatever fluids you have, the head, the stage is lifted, the centrifugal pump produce constant head. If this propane, for example, and this is one stage is lifted 100 feet head, for propane will be 100 feet, for water will be 100 feet, for oil will be 100 feet. Why? Because it's working the principle of centrifugals, you know. And since it's centrifugal forces, it's converted the velocity to the head and so on. How this is performance curve, it's constructed, and how it's, the people in the field or in the manufacturing is draw this performance curve, and how it looks like and so on. This is one stage, this one standard stage, one configuration of standard stage. It's impeller and diffusers. This one stage, this my reservoir, and this my wellbore. If I just introduce just or insert, run in my well, one stage in the well, this stage is producing a certain head. It's lifting the fluids up to a certain head. This is at zero flow. If I close around the well and I run my ESP, the ESP is running, converting the transfer the fluids to the head, not just the velocity of the flow to the head. And if it's closed, there is no zero way, there's no zero flow, then this is each stage have a certain heads can be lifted. You know, this is a maximum head at zero flow. What happened if the flow start to be increased? This is the lift head, you know, this for first stage. And if you start to draw in performance curve, this is a vertical axis, represent the head in feet. If I start to have some flow and increase flow from this pump, what will happen? The head will decrease as a function of flow, because part of the energy going to the flow, it's the flow what I have, you know, because this is total energy what I have there. Then this pump, this is stage lifting the fluids up to a certain head against a certain quantity, certain volume of fluid flow to flow. And this is what we call represent the second point in the curve. The second point in the curve here, because this is in this axis is the flow in parallel per day, and this axis in the head in feet. And at certain fluids, when I open the heads, it start to be decreased. Then I start to have a second point here. The same if I continue for the third point and I increased the amount of fluids coming just from the pump, this can be produced. The corresponding head will be also decreased. Then the third point, you can start to plot the third point in your graph. First point, while we are zero flow. Second point, at a certain flow. Increase amount flow, then you have another point. If you increase more flow, you have more flow against this head until you reach to maximum flow with zero head. Then zero head you can take from the pump at maximum flow. All the energy, all the power transferred to the flow, flow to flow the fluids and so on. This is what represents the pump performance curve in a very simple way, as a head against the production and the flow rates. Example, let me just say an example. And if I have a well like this, and the depth of these wells, I need to lift the fluids for 1,000 feet. And this well it produced 600 barrels per day. If I use the previous graph, what I already constructed, this graph which is head per stage, and I said, you know, I have 1,000 feet fluids I need to lift from the well as a net lift. Again, it's 600 barrels per day. And the fluid, what we lift, this curve is represent one stage. Remember, all the performance curve for ESP is represent one stage. Then I need to calculate how many stage I need to lift this fluid 1,000 feet. Then first of all, I need to calculate the head per stage at the corresponding production. So production is required 600 barrel per day. So at 600 barrel per day, I have a straight line to cut this curve, and it was intersecting of this curve. I go just for the vertical axis, and I calculate the head per stage. I estimate how much the head per stage for this pump, for especially for this one. Then the head per stage for this pump at 600 feet will be 40 feet. Then each stage of this pump will lift the fluid 40 feet in order to produce 600 barrels per day. If I want to produce more, then the head per stage will be less. If I want to produce less, then the head per stage will be high. Then what is the number of stage here, you know? Then the number of stage here, you know, the head per stage is 40. Then the required number of stage will be the 1,000 feet divided by 40, it is a head per stage, is gives you 25 stage. Then for this special bump with this type of bump curve and this bump performance curve, in order to produce 600 barrels per day and lift the fluid to the surface with 1,000 feet at a head over the bump or net dynamic head over the bump, I need 25 stage to run in this well, since the number of stage would be 25 feet. That's mean I need bump with a simplest minimum number of stage to have it in this pump is 25 feet. Usually we are increasing 1, 2, 3 stage, depends on, you know, type of stage, well condition, as safety factors, and different brand. Then with this 25 feet, 25 stage, you can lift fluids up to the surface. How the bump stage is working? There is a very important phenomena. The curve is not stopped here, you know. It's not only just the curve, a relationship between flow rates and the head. No, there is some other parameter you need to consider with this pump. This is centrifugal pump. You have each stage have two pieces, rotor and stators, and one of them is floating over the other, and there is a pressure over these two parts and so on, you know. Then if I have a cross section in the bump like this, and this is just can be the rotors, and this is, sorry, the rotor and the impellers, and this is just this is a part of the bump, these impellers. If you look to the impellers, the fluid over the impellers, the cross section area over the pump impellers here, it's much higher, much peak area over that, then the force corresponding to that one will be a very high force, you know. Then the large cross-section area on the impeller shrouded, just, you know, shroud or just push the impeller to be downward, to move downward during bumping operations, you know. If this shroud moved downward, what will happen for the clearance, for the area between the shrouds and the other area here, you know? This is area will be a small area. Then this area will be a small area. There will be a tendency of frictions here, you know. Then the tendency of the friction, this is force pushing downwards, creating what we call down thrust. Down thrust, that means the pump work in worst condition. There will be a high wearing tendency here in this area and so on. At some point, if the production will be high from the bottom, you know, production will be higher than the standard, the normal, what will happen here? Higher production here, then the flow will try to push these impellers up. If the fluid pushes the impellers up, what will happen? The force in the down will be much higher force, and the pump In this case, the bump stage were running what we call an up thrust bearing. See, at low production, high lifting the pump or high lift heads, the pump will work in down thrust. At high production, low heads, because the head will be low, but production will be high, the pump will work in under thrust condition. In normal operations, in the design or normal operation for this pump, you know, in normal operations, the pump is designed to operate in single, just in single to moderated down thrust. The pump usually, we have a little bit down thrust about that in this area, you know. Then that's mean, usually you try to select the pump not to have very high up thrust, very high down thrust. How to select the pump in this case, in this condition? For each performance curve of the pumps, like this one, you can find the pump, what we call, not only the pump heads against flow rates, no. You can find another also what we call pump efficiency curves. Pump, what is the efficiency of the pump at zero flow? Because there is no flow. Zero flows will be zero efficiency. At the maximum flow rates will be zero heads, and the maximum will be zero efficiency. The best efficiency of the pump will be usually at the middle of the flow rate the pump can be produced. And there is two important area here, you know. This is the area left side to what we call a recommended range, and the area to right side of the recommended range. For each centrifugal pump, there is an operating range. Operating range, which just what mean operating range? The pump can, it's running in this case, in this condition. If I go to just up thrust conditions, that's the mean run, the pump is running in this condition and you have some too much friction. If I run in low thrust, that's the pump running in this condition, I have too much wear in my impeller and diffusers for this pump. Then another important part for the pump performance curve while we are designing, while we are selecting, it's what we call the operating area. Try to select the pump within the best efficiency area, the maximum, what we call the more recommended area. Out of that area, the pump will work in either up thrust or lower thrust condition, this down thrust or just up thrust condition. Then in this area, recommended area, you have the impellers will be a floating little bit, you know, it's not will be in very high. This is what you call up thrust bearing, and this is what you call down thrust condition, and so how to select the pump, and what's the best pump? What we need to consider when we start to select the pump? First of all, based on your desired volume flow rate, you need just to know what is the bottom hole flow pressure. This you need to know that from your IPR in flow performance curve. Why I need to know that? In order to know at what depths I need to run the pump. What will be my pump intake pressures? From pump intake pressure, how much free gas will be at the pump intake pressure? How far my pump intake pressure from the bubble point, the pressure and so on. And even also from that depth, what the depth of the pumps, how much fluids they will lift up to the surface, how much net lift will go to, how much pressure, discharge pressure the pump will get. Then calculate the pump depths, you know, I like to know at the pump depths and the intake pressures, the gas and so on. I need to calculate all that parameters before I start even to select the pump. I need to know what's the pump intake pressure and what's the pump discharge pressure based on the depths, what I will select it, how much free gas, then how much will be the volume. Do I need to run a separator? Do I not need to run separator and so on? Then I need to calculate the total dynamic heads, how much the total dynamic heads the pump will be lifted to the surface and so on. After all that, I have all the parameters in my head. I have total dynamic heads, I have flow rates, I have total volumes at the pump intakes, you know, either gas plus liquids. Do I need just to separate the gas? All there is a gas in solution, whatever I have downhole, then I need to select fluids, how much fluid I need to lift, and how much head I need just the pump to be just lifted to the surface. Based on that, according to like the example what I show you, you need to determine the number of stage you have after you select the bomb and the bomb at the best condition. Finally, determine the required horsepower of the bomb required to lift this float. This pump, in order to operate it and generate the power to these fluids, it's required a certain horsepower. Certain horsepower, what you call brake horsepower for the pump, it depends on dynamic and mechanical condition of the pumps. And this is what you call, you can calculate it from your pump performance curve. And then, how the pump performance curve looks like? I said I have a heat per stage for this one. Heat per stage against flow rate. Also, I think there is an efficiency, the bomb. It should be have some efficiency care for the bomb, because the bomb at zero flow rates, so have zero efficiency, zero head at almost can zero efficiency. Then between this, you have some peak efficiency. Where is the bomb have peak efficiency? At the middle flow rates, which we can handle this bomb. Between that, there is a recommended curve. The part highlighted by yellow, this is the recommended curve while you're running the bomb. While you are running the bomb in the best performance, while you're running the bomb away from the up thrust or down thrust condition of this bomb. Then I have what we call the heat capacity or the performance curve of the bomb, plus I have bomb efficiency, and at the end, the bomb, in order to lift this float up to these feet, this amount of float, for sure is required a certain horsepower, certain torque to rotate the shaft of this pump, you know, and there's also some mechanical efficiency, depending on the pump and the pump size and state configurations and state conditions and so on. You know. Then at the end, the performance curve, as I said, represent what? Head per stage here against flow rates, and the bump efficiency against flow rates. How much the efficiency of the bump against flow rate? This point represents the best peak efficiency of that one. What else? Also, there is what we call brake horsepower, or the pump required horsepower to lift these fluids up to that head. You know, we have two axes here. You know, the primary axis and secondary axis here. Primary axis is the head per stage. Secondary axis have two values. The smallest value usually it is a horsepower, the brake horsepower. And the other value, it's efficiency, which you represent from zero up to 100% or just something like this. So for this curve, the efficiency here 20, 40, 60, 80. The brake horsepower, 1 horsepower, 2 horsepower, 3 horsepower, bare stage. Huh? All this curve represented the value, especially head bare stage, the head and the brake horsepower as bare stage. Then, for example, if I want to produce 4,000 barrel per day, how we can use this curve? You know, at 4,000 barrel per day, I go up to the head, the bomb performance curve. And just when I cut the bomb performance curve, I just go to the what we call the head stage, the head axis, and in this case will be about 42 feet this bomb in order to produce this amount float, 40,000 barrel per day. The head per stage for each stage will be around 42 feet. At the same times at 40,000, what will be the efficiency of the bomb? If I hit this is efficiency curve, then I go here, the efficiency almost of this bomb around 70%. The rest is going for dynamic, for mechanical frictions, and so on. What will be the brake horsepower? Then the brake horsepower here will be, in this point, around 1.8 horsepower. Then the performance curve for ESP represent the relationship between flow rate in the x-axis, and the head capacity in the vertical axis. The efficiency, pump efficiency in the vertical axis, secondary axis, and the brake horsepower or the power requirement also in the secondary axis. It's also shows the best efficiency point. What is the best efficiency point in this curve? It is the highest point in the efficiency curve. This is point, what we call the best efficiency point for the bomb. When you start to design, theoretically, you need to select the flow rate, the bump curve, which can give you the flow rate at the best efficiency point. There's some other consideration maybe we can explain later on, but however, you know, just as a main concept, try to start at the best efficiency point your curve. Because how can I select the bump and the curve? Then I have different curves, different bump like this. Each of them in front of me, I start to see, okay, how much production I need? I need to produce 2,000 barrels per day. No, this in 2,000 barrels per day, this is bump curve is not working because the 2,000 will be out of the recommended curve. Then I start to look to the other bump. No, until I found the bump while my required production will be in this area, especially in the best, near to the best efficiency area, then this will be my best selection for the bump and so on. Each curve is just constructed or drawing at a certain hertz, certain efficiency, certain speed. Because when the bump speed is increased, for sure the head per stage will be increased. Since the head per stage will increase, then you need to draw your curves, your pump curve, based on your running hertz. For example, in some area in the Middle East, we're running with 50 hertz at the grid hertz. In some other area in the United States and some other places, is running with 60 hertz. But in majority of the field may be running in different hertz, different with a variable speed and so on. However, you need to construct your pump performance curve at the workshop or just as a manufacturing area at a certain frequency in order to see this pump, it's just running at this frequency, at this speed, with this type of fluids and so on. For example, you can find each pump, the name of the pump like this, you know, just, you know, get you all the perform all the parameters you need to select for this pump and so on. What happens if I run the pump at different stage, at different speed, you know, because a lot of oil fields have what you call variable speed drive. Variable speed drive, you know, it's allow you to run your pumps at different speed. Since allow you to run your pump at different speed, then allow you to have different performance curve at different speed. At low speed, for sure the performance curve or recommended area will be low, because the pump production will be low. When the speed will increase, your area of recommended area will be increased and will be shifted to high volume. For that reason, if you are planned to run your wells or pump with a variable speed drive in the field, you need to construct your variable speed performance curve in order to know what will be my best. This is a curve. This line represents the best efficiency line curve while you produce this fluid using this pump. As a very, very simple way, techniques, hand calculation to design the ESP, really I recommend just to go what we call nine-step design. There is a manufacturing introduced this is to, especially to the student, to the field engineers, which is not have on hand some computers or just some software and so. There's a very simple technique. The ESP design, it's one of the very simple technique for design. What we call, there is a nine-step design technique. If you search in the internet, you can find this, and really it's explained in very detailed with example, you know, and can give you a very good, a very good information about how to select your pump and design. This just summarize, you know, I put here just to summarize what you need. As I said, for all type of artificial, for all your design, either you design or troubleshooting, you need to collect all the well and fluid properties data. You need to collect all the data in front of you before you start the design. Whatever you assume can be lead to some wrong output. If you assume something, maybe it can be good, maybe it can lead to some wrong output for or wrong design, wrong selection. And so I need also just to make sure that when I start to select or calculate it, my downhole displacement, remember, downhole displacement for the bump, I need just to use the bump, sorry, the inflow performance curve. Please try not to use the value of PIs. PI productivity index is a straight line, unless you are producing above the bubble point pressure, or for water wells. But for all oil wells, try to use your inflow performance while below the bubble point, will be a curvatures, and then the volume of liquids will be decreased and the volume of gas will be increased. You need to calculate the volume of your fluids, including gas at the pump intake, especially the gas which will be entered to the pump. You'll force it to pump into the pump, and you need to calculate the dynamic head, taking into consideration all the parameters. I will show you on the next slide what's mean of dynamic head, and what's the factor, what the parameters input in your dynamic head calculations. You know, you need to select the pump at the highest possible efficiency of the pump flow rate. You need to optimize your old equipment based on downhole condition, based on downhole parameters, and so on. You need to select the correct size and types and configuration of your electrical cables. You know, same for the motor, transformation, the transformers, and so on. And if there is any optional equipment required, also you need just to select carefully, because any additional piece of equipment, if you not need it and you run in the wells, can be a source of failure, can be a source of problem. If you don't need any piece of equipment downhole, don't run, unless you know it's a required, and so on. With any piece, extra piece you run and you don't need extra tool downhole, can be a source of failure, and so on. Then while you are just, I would like to remind you again, you know, while you are start to select your pump, first point to calculate your pump intake pressures and your production rate using the total, what you call total inflow performance, that's the flow rate at the pump condition, not at the stock tank condition, plus the volume of gas. Do you plan, just do you have ability to separate all the gas? It's good and well. If you don't have any ability to separate all gas, then you need to calculate the volume of gas. Do you plan to use a special type of pump? Then the volume of gas will be also calculated, and so on. Then if I want, for example, to produce this volume at the tank, I need to design my pump displacement. If there is no gas, zero gas, to displace downhole, this is volume of liquid. If there is gas and I am not able to vent all gas or separate all the gas, it's all free, at this case, this amount of free gas plus the liquid, then I need to sizing my downhole pumps to lift this flow. Whatever volume of gas you need to separate, then the volume you are required to size in the pump will be decreased until you reach to this point, and so on. Then one of the other important factors, how to calculate, because now I calculated my pump displacement, the volume of production I need to displace by the pump. But how I can calculate the lift, the head, this pump required to lift this flow, the discharge pressures, how much pressure this pump need to generate it just to move the fluid from the bottom to the surface, not only to the surface, up to the separators, up to the inside separator. Then after I calculated my bottom hole flow pressure, how much discharge pressure, then the delta P between bottom hole flow pressure and discharge pressure, this is what we call delta P, the net lift of the pump, what will be lifted here in this flow. What is the drive head, the total dynamic head, or the lift of the pump looks like, and what the parameters including? This is my well. This is my bottom hole assembly, ESP assembly. This is my formations. This is my tubing. This well heads, my well heads. And this is a well head pressure reading sensor, this casing pressure sensor. And this is my ground lift. Then, first of all, you know, I need just to calculate these are fluid levels. If the pump is running and this fluid level, which is corresponding to the bottom hole flow pressure, if I calculate the bottom hole flow pressure according to the fluid gravity here, this will be the fluid level. Then the pump will lift from here to the surface, because from here to here, it's YouTube. The fluid can lift itself up to this point. Then the net lift, the pump will generate what you call net vertical lift. It's from fluid level up to the surface. Okay? What else? What the second term is in this in this case, in this condition. There is a pressure loss. Fluids flow inside the tubing. Since the fluids flow inside the tubing, will be a friction loss. But the friction loss, in order to calculate, because the fluid is flow from the pump up to the surface inside the tubing, not only from fluid level. Then I need to calculate the pressure, the total friction loss from the outlet of the pump, from the discharge. Sometimes some people maybe can consider some pressure inside the pump. However, let us consider now it's the pressure loss from out of the pump up to the surface. The second term, second part in total dynamic head calculations. And you have leak lift, I have the pressure loss due to for fluid. Plus the outlet pressure, these fluids will move, you know, just bump, will move fluid against a certain outlet pressure in order to allow the fluid to go to the separator. And then I have three main parameters here. Also, there is some other important parameter here, and some people is ignored, is the casing will hit pressures. Yes, this is a net lift, net vertical lift for fluid from here to here. But this, if I have the casing pressure zero, if I have a casing pressure with a certain value, I need just to add this value to this, just, you know, to subtract it, this value from here, because casing pressures is required, just, you know, it's a pressure with this is fluid to you, because if you remove the casing pressure, the fluid level will go up. The casing pressure here, if you have any pressure, is push the casing, the fluid level to go down. Then I need to subtract the value equivalent to the casing pressure. How much this pressure according to the fluid gravity, then I convert to the feet and so on. Then the vertical lift here, it's fluid level minus the casing pressure here and so on. Then the total dynamic heads here, it's equal the net lift plus net lift minus the casing pressure plus the pressure loss plus the total friction loss plus the well head pressures. How to select the pump? Usually for each manufacturing have a certain pump specification like this table, you know. If you go to any catalog for each manufacturing, you will find different pump with different configuration. Say series, the pump series, type of the pump, and what type of this pump for each series of this pump. What is the production rate at different hertz, 50 hertz and 60 hertz? What is the production rate at the best efficiency? And what is the operating range? For example, here for this pump at series 400, FC 400, they inform you that your production at best efficiency out from this pump is 400. However, this pump can run in a very good way in the, within the recommended range from 250 up to 530. Out of that, the pump will be either up thrust or lower thrust will be a problem, and the running life will be much less. This if you run the pump at 60 hertz. If you run the pump at 50 hertz, in this case, you know, then the efficiency will be much less and so on. For longer running life of your equipment, you try to select, you know, what you call the pump with the flow rate, it's a little bit to a right side of the best efficiency point, because there is a tear and wear in the pump, and with the running operation, then the pump performance, we can go down. Then we can go, you will be still running within your recommended operating range of this pump, and so on. This at the end, the performance curve, as I show you before, and I explained to you before. Number of stage, how to select the number of stage for this pump. The number of stage, it will be like total dynamic head, which we already calculated before, divided by head per stage for this. But you know, each pump, you know, there is a certain, what you call, certain housing for the pump, the length. This is a housing of the pump. There is a standard housing length for each manufacturer for the pump. Then after you calculating the number of stage, you need just to select the right housing to just in order to, you know, to install the stage inside this housing of this pump. Then usually you select housing with a capacity of stage higher than the calculated stage. For example, if I calculated the number of stage, the required number of stage, it's 50 stage. I according to total dynamic head, the Hilbert stage, I say, okay, I need 50 stage to run this system. What is the nearest housing of this bump house can be accommodated my 50 stage? I go down here, I found nearest one is 52. I cannot use 34. Then I use 52 and I install two more stage. This bump, instead to run with 50 stages, running with 52 stage and 50 little bit more heats, you know, just as safety factors and so on. Then bump load, you know, remember for the performance curve. What happened? Sorry for that. Remember for the performance curve of the bump, we said we need to calculate the bump horsepower, how much horsepower I required in order how to design the motor, how to select the motors. In order to select the motor horsepower, I need to know the pump horsepower, how much horsepower required for this pump to lift the flow. Then I need to calculate the horsepower, what you call brake horsepower. The pump horsepower, it's dynamic and mechanical, total together, you know, which calculated or just from the pump performance curve. Then the pump horsepower increase and decrease with the specific gravity of the flow. This is a horsepower, because, you know, just in order to rotate these fluids and the torque required for this fluid and so on. Then the pump load and the maximum load in order to calculate is equal. The brake horsepower for each stage multiplied by the number of stage multiplied by the specific gravity of the fluid you have. After the selection of the suitable pump and you calculate your pump horsepower, you need to know what type of pump intake I need. Is the standard pump intake or gas separator? Because for each one of them, it's required a certain horsepower to rotate. If it's standard, it will, maybe it's just less than one horsepower or just zero horsepower, very few horsepower required. But if gas separator is required a certain torque to rotate, certain torque to operate this one, then you need a certain horsepower. Then you need to select how much the horsepower required to rotate this my pump intake. Same for the seal section. Then I need just to select after select the pump, select the intake, select the seal section. After I select the intake, select seal section, I need to calculate how much horsepower required to rotate. Only to rotate, this is intake, especially if it's a gas separator, how much horsepower required to rotate the seal section. Then I start to just, you know, to add it all that all together in order to calculate how much power required for the motor, what's the horsepower required for this motor. Then at the end, the motor horsepower, or just what you call the brake horsepower for the motor, is equal bump horsepower, bump load plus intake load plus the seal section load. At the end, you need to select the cables, and you need to select the cable carefully, especially if it's deviated well, especially if it's deep well, especially if you have what you call the high temperatures downhaul, especially if there is a corrosion environment and so on, you know, what type of vault you need just to have inside, to run your motors and to bath inside this cable and so on. Then the probable size of cable depend on combination factors, not only one factors. You need to know how much voltage drop. You need to select the minimum possible voltage drop, either 30 voltage drop per 1,000 feet or 15% of the motor nameplated voltage, you know, per 1,000 feet or so. What is the amperage, you know, can be about through this motor, you know, according to the voltage and so on. You know. What's the available space, one of the important parameters, what's the available space between your tubing string and your casing, especially at the coupling point and so on. This is just, you know, just a quick overview, a quick hints. I give you some hints about selection design. And I still recommend it to go through this 9-step design over the internet you can find. And you do some exercise. There is a lot of solved solution examples, you can go and you can review. It will give you a very good background. And there is plenty of softwares can help you in order to sizing your equipment. But you need to understand how I can calculate it, especially my initial parameters to input to this software and so on. Let give me some hint about ESP technology and problems. What the market, the technology in the market, what's the problem usually the ESP faced or challenged to use ESP and so on. ESP technology really, it's, as I said before, it's improved too much. And the concept of the centrifugal is used for different cases, different conditions to solve a lot of problem, you know. Use a centrifugal to separate sand. Use a centrifugal force to separate gas and so on. They are using this phenomena, this important forces with the ESP in order just to help to eliminate it, some of the problem can create for the ESP. First thing is what we call ESP gas solution. The ESP gas solution, ESP, you know, with the high gas content can create a lot of problem, like excessive heat, because there is no cooling effect for the gas. You have some weird, premature weirs, because I don't know, no cooling for this is bearing for assemblies of downhauls, and can have some weird, have some slugging. You can have gas look in the worst case, worst condition. You have some mechanical stress over the bomb and so on, you know. If I use usually, you know, first of all, if there is a standard pump, I must be used, then the percentage of free gas as a pump intake should be not more than 10 to 20%. Then when I can start to say, okay, there is a gas, but it's around 10% or 15%, the ESP can handle that up to 10% to 20% with a standard pump configuration without serious problem, without big problem. But if the gas start to be increased, the first choice for me is start to use what we call the gas separators. The gas separators is required just to separate the gas and vent the gas to the annulus. And usually this used with a standard condition. But if you have no vent capability of the gas in the annulus, then the gas separator will be useless to be used and so on. There is not only gas separators, you know, gas separator is the first choice because it's one of the just, you know, good choice to separate the gas. But currently speaking, you know, just in all the markets, there is a lot of technology for the ESP. Like, you know, just there is different pump configurations, different pillars, shapes, different pump types, different downhole technology can be used to separate the gas, such as, you know, for example, one it's called, one manufacturing called, what you called gas handler, can handle the gas inside the pumps and so on, you know. Gas handler can alone, you know, without separators, can handle up to 50% of free gas. The volume of the free gas as a pump, you know. This technology is designed just, you know, just as a gas handler to move the heavier fluids, you know, to outside of the fluid, you know, while of the fluid column, you know, while free gas migrated to the centers of the pump and so on. When you combine this gas handler or some other new technology, similar technology to that one, some of the manufacturing, you know, just said that he can reach it up to 80 to 10% of free gas he can handle at the pump intake and so on. But generally speaking, what is the strategy usually the operators taking and the manufacturing taking in order to manage the gas? Because the gas is a problem. The gas is high volume and this area of the pump, you know, and reducing your lifting cost, you're reducing your downhole efficiency, your volumetric efficiency, and so on, you know. There is four recommended strategies. There is more, but, you know, usually the recommended strategy, there is four recommended strategies. First strategy and just logic, it's what avoiding try to avoid gas in whirlpool from entering the pump. How to do that? Do just avoid the gas, run the pump below the perforation with some shroud. Do all your best to run the pump with a pump intake above the bubble point if you are able to reduce your production. By any means, try to avoid the gas entering the pump. One of the main important things to avoid the gas entering to the pump also, try to separate the gas and avoiding this gas to enter to the pump. Separate the gas before just reach it to the pump intake, or at the pump intake, separated the gas and diverted the free gas to the casing, annulus casing and venting to the surface. What else? Try to process like this technology, what I mentioned before, you know, like a gas handlers, like some other type configurations of the pump, handling gas, tapered pump, some other type of pump. And so try to process the gas, put the gas in solution again, you know, inside the pump, and then the gas can be separated after they lift the pump inside the tubing and so on. And also you can control from steps by using different variable speed drive, different controllers. You are monitoring downhole and control cycling, and do whatever techniques to reduce the volume of gas inside the pump and so on. What else, you know, there is more techniques, you know, for handling the gas, like this condition, you know, this condition, if you're handling the gas and you need to use a special type of gas handling pump, it's usually replace the standard pump, you know. Gas handling pump usually replaces the standard pump. This can be standard pump, this gas handler pump, different type, different manufacturing, different conditions, different impeller, different structures from inside and so on. However, you know, in the market, as I said, you know, there's different technology. You need to avoid the gas entering to the pump. You need to have different gas separators. You need to separate the gas. It's dynamic, static. You need to have some pump technology to, you know, just have some homogeneous fluid to the pump, you know, to process the pump, the fluid inside the pump, handling and processing and handling. You can have more controller from the surface. Was a combination, you know, you can use only one of these, or you can usually is a people use combination of that, you know, control from the surface with a gas separator, control from the surface with certain bump technology configuration. Also, you can use a three together, you know, and you can have better efficiency, depend on the gas, volume on gas, Baltimore condition, and so on. What the other problem for the ESP is the salt, sand, debris. It's one of the biggest problem also, not only for ESP, for all artificial lift have moving part downhole, like ESP, like the road lift system and so on. However, in the market, there is different strategy to do that. First strategy to have a separations, sand screen and to separate the gas from entering to the pump, you know. This is one of the first choice, and really in the market, there is a very good technology like what is produced by the Odessa separator and some other. They have a very good technology in for this downhole separation for the sand and gas, even together for ESP and so on, you know. You need to use a special, what you call special pump stage, pressure and resistance pump stage, you know, special coating, not only special resistance pump stage, special coating. This is all in order to increase the running life for that. Special pump like this ones, what we call sand cut pumps, you know, just diverted the pump outside. They use a centrifugals concept here, you know, and just, you know, they are diverted the pump outside. There is another good pumps also just called contract pump or V-pump or some other pumps. There is a lot of technology in this area improving how to use the ESP with good volume of sand contents and so on. Then you need to have a pressure resistance technology for your stage, for your pump configuration, for housing of the pump, the stage coating. You need to run with a good completion with sand screen, a good type of sand screen, you know, and you need to have sand screen with very good selection to just isolate a certain volume of sand based on the sand size and the sand size as a micron and so on, or the pump technology in the market. There is a lot of pump technology and so on. This just as a brief for sand and gas, because it's really two problems of that. What other basic optimization and troubleshooting for ESP? What is the main point I need to look for ESP in order just to see how it's running good, running bad, there is sand, there is gas, there is flow, there is no flow, it's how to monitoring the system and so on. I will go this in a very brief about a couple of slides and so on for that. Many conditions can be probably diagnosed and corrected before the problem can be occurring, you know, without the need to pull the equipment to run home. From the surface reading, from the surface equipment, if you're monitoring some parameters, you can do a lot of corrective action before the failures is occur. And this is just will lead that you just will help you to avoid pulling your equipment and high cost pulling the equipment and so on. The first and very simple technique is used before and still some people is used. It's called recording the amp at the surface. It's what we call the ammeters or just amp chart. The amp is reflect the power consumed or just by the motors. And the motor is drive the seal. The motor is drive the intake. The motor is drive the pump. Then any change in this this component on this part for sure will reflect to the motors. If the pump, there is a gas, there is a fluctuation in the load in the pump, then for sure the ampere withdrawal by the motor will be affected. Then the ampere can be your eyes as a diagnostic tools, variable, very basic diagnostic tools we can use. You know. This is an amper chart or just a record amp. It's just only monitoring. Just only can tell you what's going on downhole, but it's not a controller equipment. It's not a controller system. You know, only monitoring the amp, only record the amp with the cycles, with the complete cycles of the pump. You know, it's not the only tool for engineering to make a decision. You know, you need to take this is amp reading, and you need just to look to what's going downhole, what's going on the surface, how your production looks like, how your gas at the surface, how your pressure fluctuation at the surface, and you need to just do your corrective action. And the second, very important, and really there is a very good technology in this, what we call remote real-time monitoring and control. Currently, you can remote and control your ESP system using your mobile app, which there is a lot of softwares, a lot of platforms, a lot of new technology in the markets, you know, it can tell you what's going on downhole, especially if you are using downhole sensors and downhole sensors to read a lot of data downhole. This can tell you what's going on downhole. Based on that, you can recommend it to you what action is required and so on. Not only that, there is some new platforms can also predict it, what failure can be having. And the failure can be happening after how many days or how many months or how many weeks and so on. You know. This is just, you know, recording. I just like to show you four examples. You know, there is a lot of examples, but this is one of the four common examples for the amp charts and how to read the amp chart. Usually, if the pump is running normal with standard conditions and so on, the amp will be steady, you know. There is no fluctuation in the amp. The motor running steady, the load over the motor. There is no change in the load. The bearing, there is no problem with the motor bearings. There is no problem with the pump bearings, with the seal or whatever. No problem with any piece of the downhole assembly. Then the motor's amp will be very, very smooth. This is just startup. When I start, usually have very peak for the current, like each electrical equipment. But what happens if there is a gas? The gas usually fluctuated. The gas density, there is a slugging of the gas, there is a bubble of the gas, then the load over the motors will be fluctuated. And when you see the chart with the amp fluctuated continuously like this, like the gas, this is indicated there is some free gas inside the pump, because the free gas inside the pump will be dependent on the pressure and the bubble size will be increased, decreased, and so on. Then the load will be fluctuated over the pump. When you see a chart with this fluctuation like this, that means you have a free gas inside the pump and you need to have a very corrective actions. Try to check your venting, from the casing, venting efficiency is good or not, all the gas is vented or not, just you like to see how we can run down all separators or just special type of bomb, how severe this is gas inside the bomb and so on. This gas, you know, when the gas volume start to be increased, you know, this was more increase of gas volume, creating what you call gas lock or pump off. You know, some people try to put the well either in pump off or gas lock. Pump off or under to reduce this peak, you know, of the gas. Then with a time stop until you have a very good bottom well pressure, start it again, and then you have some pump running when you start the gas. To be sure like this, you have a bump off, the bump in cycling, you know, just bump off with gas interference, this condition and so on. Or if you have a problem with your current at the surface, the pump is running okay. Downhole equipment is running okay. But from time to time, you have a peak here in the current, peak on the current, peak on the current. This most probably you have primary power fluctuation spikes at the surface. As the ESP monitoring technology and more than 90%, 80% of the world worldwide for the time being usually use this as a remote or just can be at the site or just can be remote monitoring new technology, what you call advanced ESP monitoring system, which is used a surface, just, you know, use just a surface equipment like this to monitoring, to analyzing your downhole reading if you have a choice running sensor downhole. Downhole reading for sensor, which is can read pressure, temperatures, power motoring, operating parameters, all the parameters of the power motor, vibration in all the direction of the motor, if there is a vibration, if there is a sand, there is some problem downhole, what is a pump intake pressures, and what's a pump discharge pressures, if there is any current leaking, I measure the current as surface, current as a motor, if there is any current leakage downhole. There is a very good technology in reading downholes, you know, equipment. If my monitoring system equipped with this, really I can have a very good control, a very good optimization for my system and so on. This is just a quick overview about the ESP system and how we use ESP system, what's the main component of the ESP system, how to design the ESP system, what's the main challenge for the ESP system and so on. I would like to thank you a lot and Hassan, if there is any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Gharib, for the wonderful session. I have
Hello?
Joined just recently. We have one of the participants is asking, can viscosity affect the height to which we can pump a fluid?
Yes, it can affect, yes, because, you know, remember, viscosity, there is will be a lot of pressure loss, and the pump is depend, you know, on what we called in centrifugal force. And if you look to all the charts for the ESP, it says that this chart for the water, then it's consider water viscosity. Yes, you need to correct for viscosity for sure.
Okay, Dr. Gharib, we have one more question. A student is asking, how much efficiency does the sand cat have?
Sand cats can have a very good efficiency. Usually, you know, according to the case study, case history, and the SPE paper publication, you know, they said they can have, because, you know, the efficiency depends on the volume of sand, huh, by the way. But they said that they can have a very good efficiency, can reach the, really more than 50%. You know.
Okay, Dr. Gharib, we have just received these two questions. I think our participants have learned the most out of it today, so they have a few queries. Thank you so much, Dr. Gharib, for the well-explained lecture, and I'm glad to have you for more lectures as well. And we would be glad to see you again next time. Thank you.
Shukran. Thank you. Thank you, Hassan.